So here, what I hope to do is share thoughts on innovation in food and why I'm optimistic about our food system, why there's reason to be concerned. And I hope maybe this conversation inspires your inner innovator, maybe even your inner entrepreneur. So I'm going to go fast as to the problems in food. And here, there's been a lot of industrial agriculture. And that's great. That's really lowered the cost of food so we could feed populations as our populations scale. At the same time, big ag leads to often clumsy ag. So this is a picture of crop dusting that leads to a lot of pesticides. We also have over-fertilization that leads to river runoff, leads to algae blooms, dead zones. We also have problems with food waste, and there's a tremendous amount of food waste and challenges in our whole supply chain. People have read about our challenges in droughts. All of this when we have population growth. By some estimates, we need 50% more food by 2050. So enough of the problems. Now let's talk about the solutions. So I'm a believer that the best way to start a company, and I'm a serial entrepreneur, starting off in nanotech, something I didn't study much of. And really, it's about scientific exploration and how do you take technological enablers to build companies. So whether it's data analytics, computing power, diodes, LEDs, artificial intelligence, robotics, genetics, synthetic biology, there are all these innovations going on today that are enabling industries, like, or changing industries right now. And I'm going to give four examples. So these are companies that I've either led as CEO or chairman and helped build that illustrate different ways that those enablers can change our food system and our ag system. So first, AeroFarms. So here, this is vertical farming enabled by LEDs. So LEDs, a light emitting diode, and realizing that LEDs really brought the ability to illuminate and bring lights to plants in an indoor setting. So before that, it would have had to be like high pressure sodium or incandescent lights, and the energy load is way too high. If you touch a light and it's hot, that's because it's yellow spectrum. And with LEDs, you could change the spectrum to cooler spectrums that really optimize photosynthesis and use a lot less energy. And coupled that with robotics and really full control of the environment, you could grow plants, whether it's on the equator or the North Pole, 365 days a year. And agriculture before that was taking the genetics and optimizing taking the genetics to the environment, wherever it is. That's why you have different plants that only grow in some parts of the world. What we're able to do with fully controlled agriculture is really take the environment to the genetics. So customize, whether it's temperature, humidity, CO2 even, to optimize plant growth. And what that enables is now you could start unlocking problems in ways you haven't done. And it's not just about yield, it's about taste, texture, nutrition, shelf life, color, all of these different attributes. And it's a fun time where the world really is ignorant on what makes a plant grow. And here you could unlock this mystery through a lot of data analytics, trial and error. So how do you isolate a variable, test an assumption, to figure out what gets a plant growing fast? And that AI, once you have the data and you really digitize the virtual world, you could really amplify the solutions and figure out how to grow much faster. So we've grown plants in a fraction of the time that one would otherwise do in the field. And to quantify that, if one has 3 harvests a year in the field, we've done so with as many as 90 indoors, just by controlling that seasonality and also speeding up plant growth. If we were all one of our plants, I'd say you're contributing to CO2. Plants are carbon-based, and that additional CO2 is one way to juice up plant growth. You'll see a lot of, a moderate amount of robotics. So here, when you automate, you roboticize, it's either to lower capital cost or to improve quality. And here we could do both. That also reduces the risk of certain disease spreading through the plants. So it's really unlocking biology in a quite unique way to accelerate plant growth and enabling local food production all over. Another way to illustrate it, we took, in some cases, plant growth from 24 days to 14 days, and in some plants, we're doing it even 4 days. So here it depends on the crop and the maturity, but all these ways of understanding the environmental side or the environmental stresses to optimize plant growth. Just like if we eat, sleep differently, exercise differently, it changes our biochemistry. Here we're changing the phytochemistry of plants. So now taking that same concept of controlled agriculture, applying it to other plants or insects, animals, so crickets. So here at Aspire, we grow crickets. And crickets is a great source of nutrition. And we just built a facility that's about the size of this campus here at Riverdale. Imagine a building 8 stories high growing crickets in these totes. So here there are about 50,000 totes that zip around with robotics and automation. And we're understanding how crickets eat, how they drink, how they hide. If you grow crickets the wrong way, you could have 90-80% cannibalism. So how do you get crickets to grow in a way where they're not eating each other? What do you want to eat them? Where are the foods placed? And this is, again, understanding biology in ways that people haven't understood, whether it's plants or insects or animals, unlocked by data analytics, machine learning, and ultimately it really drives the economics. So this is an image of the facility. And here, a lot of robotics. We have about 12 robotic arms, and most of that's to lower the labor costs. And here you'll see the amount of, and some change, I'd argue one needs behavioral change, not just technological change. But this is in beef, pork, or poultry, the different land use, water use, emissions, feed use. So crickets is the most efficient way I've seen to produce a protein. And we used to sell to humans, and people didn't had a trouble with the ick factor. I knew when I couldn't get my kids to eat it, I was in trouble. But so now we sell it to pet food and dog food. And the other like interesting parts that, like an example we learned is crickets don't like to, and this was, I'm sharing this, this was a new realization just in the last month, they don't like to eat where they poop, which not many people do. So we had to figure out ways to like separate the where the cricket mouths go from the cricket butts. And I could tell you a lot of R&D goes to like the configuration inside a tote to improve the habitat to optimize biology. And here too, like the data analytics just unlocks a lot of this innovation. You have a lot of experimentation that you need to figure out what's going on. Here we're working to go from 4 pounds to 20 pounds in a tote. And we're achieving this in R&D. Now we need to scale it up. Scaling biological systems sometimes doesn't happen in an obvious way. Here's another company, and here we genetically sequenced an egg. So eggs are obviously come from chickens, and if you're allergic to chickens, there's something called biologically exact. This is an exact genetics or chemistry as an egg, but we don't make it from chickens. We make it from precision fermentation. Fermentation, just similar to a beer, we put in yeast, we put in sugar, we cook it in a certain way, and we work on the strain development, the eggs. We also work on the precision fermentation and the process engineering, how often to cook it, how fast. And then we also work on the formulation, how it mixes into products. And people use eggs either for foaming properties, gelatinous properties, or binding properties, and we could even enhance those properties. And there's a tremendous amount of work going on in genetics. So with this, I built a company, Inspired Growing. You might have seen the growing system out in the hall. And I did this to inspire kids to care about food and to eat. It's not just, and back to behavioral change, it's not just about what calories we eat, but what nutrition we eat. So how do we get kids to do that? It's through experiential learning and try growing it themselves, have some pride in what they're growing, and experiment. Sometimes biology, it goes well, sometimes it doesn't. And here too, this is partnering with Bell Labs, an image. You could get a lot of information from an image. You could get the space, the width, the height, the stem length, the petiole length, the curvature, spotting, ripping, discoloration. It all means something. So how do we take and digitize the physical world and biology and understand what the environmental stresses are? How do you get faster yield growth? Or how do you get better taste? You could amplify bitterness, sweetness, pepperiness, all of this. And how do we get the kids to experiment, to innovate, trial things? I love here at Riverdale, they grew pumpkins. I've never grown pumpkins. And they had some, the kids painted on the pumpkins. And then instead of throwing out the pumpkins, they cleaned the seeds, planted the seeds. And the before you get the big round orange pumpkin that we know of, you get a little leaf and they ate the leaves. And it was great. Experiment, try new things. And understand how the morphology changes, the nutrition changes of a plant, and get the kids to understand cause and effect. So we set up these little experiments, and it gets people to understand not only the biological and the genetics, but the environmental stresses. So what we hope to do is improve this pace of experimentation and ultimately leading to the pace of innovation. This is amaranth that's also out there, and color, and get kids, especially in places where there are pockets of food deserts, to have access to fresh food. And if when kids don't eat food or the right food early on, your eating habits get sort of locked in. So how do we nurture those right eating habits early on? And there is some great technology, talk about enablers, that just came out a week ago. It was launched with Google, part of their DeepMind system, AlphaFold 3. And what this does is it allows a 3D image of proteins and molecules and how they interact with each other. So if you make a genetic sequence change, whether it's through CRISPR or genetic modified organisms, but you could make genetic changes, you don't know what the cause and effects are. But with a tool like AlphaFold 3, it all of a sudden allows you to experiment much faster on the genetic side. And we as human species, when we work to solve our food problems, our agriculture problems, we need to address it from the plant science world, the environmental stresses, but also the genetics. And the amount of innovation that's going to come out of the world in the next decade, two decades, is going to be fantastic. And these are tremendous unlocks that is going to not only allow for innovation, but industry changes, and ultimately to de-risk the supply chain risks, the challenges that we face. So there's a lot to do. We need to go fast. And I hope people embrace this, experiment more, and again, possibly even become an entrepreneur. Thank you very much.